Hello everyone, this is Göksu from MGMB 101 project. My teammates are Metan Uzun, Mert İstanuz, and Fengsu Doğanay. Our supervisor for this project is Murat Karakaya. Today we would like to present to you the final model of our system and also our mobile application. Firstly, I would like to remind you our project's aim. This project will provide convenience to manufacturers and consumers in the construction sector. With our system, a consumer can determine the type of a marble without needing an expert person. Also, this system can distinguish marbles whose colors are really close to each other, but whose type is different. Also, this system will reduce the transactions related to wrong type of marble. Next, please. We are collecting our own data sets. We collect them from articles and advertisement agencies. Our data set consists of 7 classes that are Afyon Beyaz, Afyon Gray, Beige Marble, Kaplan Posto, Karacabey Black, Crystal Emperador, and other type of marbles. In other type of marbles class, we collect images from every class and also the data we had that didn't fit into any class. We have 1,230 data and at the right hand side, you can see some samples from our data set. We split our data into 2 sections, testing and training data. After that, we split some of the data from training into validation data. We used image data generator function for pre-processing the data at first. We did some rotations, shifts, flips, and also zoomed and filled the nearest boundaries. We repeated this for training and validation data. We fixed our data's height and weight into 224 by 224 pixels. Our batch size is 8, and as I mentioned before, we have 7 classes.
May I ask a question, Göksu?
Yes, of course.
Why 8 is the batch size?
Because we did some we tried and we determined that the 8 is better.
Anyone can answer this question? Metan, why 8 is the batch size? Why 8 is chosen as the best batch size?
It's hyperparameter, I think. We tried different numbers.
Why not 9? Why not 7?
I think 7 or 9 is not so differentiable. I think 8 is that's all 8. We tried 8 and we use 8.
Mert İhsan, do you have an idea?
I have an idea, but can I it should be divided 2 and the highest batch size can be can be overfit in the performance rating.
Overfit. And Göksu, Bengisu.
Also, teacher, but batch size means number of training example. Maybe we choose the 8.
Actually, how many examples, total examples in train set?
And 1,000 and 200.
In train.
But without image data generator.
So at least you have 1,000. Did I understand correct?
Yes.
So with the image generator, it could be more than 2,000, I believe. Right? So yeah. Actually, yes. Batch size can be chosen such that it should fit the GPU memory, not more than that GPU memory. That's the maximum size. And it shouldn't be very few. Otherwise, it takes a lot of time to update the weights and biases with backpropagation. So it should be an optimum size. And in your case, I believe that the optimum size is not 8. I believe you need to check it. Because you can use 64, 128. These numbers can work with yours. Because you have at least 200 or 2,500 images in the train set, I believe. So by giving each time 8, calculating these errors and updating the weights with 8, so you have lots of steps for each training cycle, epoch. Do you understand what I am saying?
Yes, hocam.
Yes, but 100 is 100 so high?
No, I think 124 might be working, or 84. You need the 84 maybe, 128. I don't know, you should try, but as long as GPU can support this batch size, then you should increase it.
Okay, we will try.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
According to your data. Let's continue. Yes.
The flow from directory method takes the path to a directory and generates batches of augmented data. We give directories to every set. We fix the image size. Then the return type is two-dimensional one-hot encoded labels. So the class mode is categorical. We don't shuffle the validation data. We use them in alphanumerical order, but we shuffle the training data.
Hello everyone, my name is Bengisu Tanay and I will explain transfer learning and our best model. Transfer learning is a machine learning that focus on storing the knowledge gain and while solving a problem and applying it to a different but related to the problem. In short, it is the reuse or transfer of information from previous learned task to learn new task. As you seen on the slide, transfer learning is the process of the transferring a previously trained model to a new model by either the copying the weights or adding a new prediction layer. It's common to the transfer learning with predictive modeling problems that use image data as input, and this input is a photo or video data. And ImageNet is used for such problems. Also, there is a need for the use of hyperparameters during the transfer learning because hyperparameters are algorithm parameters that do not affect the performance of the model, but affect speed and performance. In the other sense, we can say that they are used to control the learning process. Values of the other process are learned, but the hyperparameter values are given manually. Next. In this model, our best model, which we use ResNet, also why we use the ResNet, because the residual values are formed by adding the blocks, adding next layers to the model. It accelerates the training process of the model and provides the least error rate. I will explain this code part. First of all, we determine our rate with ImageNet as a hyperparameter. The reason ImageNet is a hyperparameter is not is that contains a large scale image and a large amount of categories, and we switch the transfer learning using this parameter. Also, we set the include top false. Include top is equal to false because the output of the previous layer passed through a global average pooling 2D function, and that extracts most important features. Then layer trainable again is equal to false, that moves all the layers weights from trainable to non-trainable. This is called freezing the layer. The state of the frozen layer won't be updated during training. I want to train exist weights. Also, we are using the global average pooling 2D and for preventing the overfit. Also, we use the dense layers are used when associates can exist among any feature to any other feature in data point.
Flattened layers. Bengusu, can I ask a question?
Yes, teacher.
Here in the in the beginning, for layer in RESTNET model layers, column -15, layer trainable false. What do you understand from these two lines of code, the first two lines of code in the slide? What do you understand? What does it mean, -15?
I think it means that the end of the arrays. I don't know.
Okay. What about Göksu? Do you know?
I'm actually not sure about it.
Okay, Mert.
It starts from end of the array, and the first one can be trainable, but the others one trainable false.
Which others? Which others? I didn't understand.
First, last one. Can be trainable, but the others
last one, only one layer.
No, 15 layers.
Meta.
Last 15 layers. Layer trainable false. Which layers? Last 15 layers.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Or inverse. Other than the last 15 layers, trainable false. Yeah, it's saying that up to the last 15 layers, the trainable is false. What about the last 15 layers? Their weights can be updated during the train process. Am I right?
Can you repeat it?
Okay.
Because I think I am sure.
Up to the last 15 layers, these layers are not trainable. But the last 15 layers are trainable. So their weights can be updated during the train process.
Yes, yes, yes. You are right.
Because you wrote there, the last 15 layers fine-tuned.
Yes, yes, you are right, you are right. I couldn't explain this.
What you are doing? Why last 15 layers?
Because in the first one, we trained the weight, and the rest of the, if you already trained the weights, so we set up the trainable force.
For all layers? Not...
Sorry?
Did you do it for all layers? Did you freeze all layers?
No.
At the first try, did you freeze all the layers?
Except first one. The other ones, trainable equals false. Except for first one, first day. Because in the beginning, we will train. We will find the way.
Since you don't have many data, many samples, it's not a good idea to train 15 layers. It's not a good idea. Because the trainable, you are using a pre-trained model, but now you are updating 15 layers of it. It's not a logical, sensible. It doesn't sound correct.
Should we increase the number?
Yes, you should keep all of them freeze, for example. Because your data is not so many. Your samples are very few, not thousands, hundred thousands or so millions, but in ResNet model is worked or trained on millions of data. Now you are trained to update much of that model, 15 layers. You are trained to update this weight with 1,000 images.
We will increase.
It doesn't sound right. Do you understand my point?
Yeah, I understand.
Okay, hocam.
If I were you, I would keep all of the layers untrainable. So trainable false, all of the layers. Maybe the last layer, maybe. Minus one, minus two, maybe. But not the others. And 15 shouldn't be a generic number, random number. You need to check the ResNet model because there are the residential blocks. You need to take care of which blocks you will take or not. So it's not a random number. You need to think about that. If you are unfreeze these layers, it means that their weights will be updated back propagation process. And since you don't have enough images, it's not a good idea to change their weights. Do you understand this?
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, teacher.
Yeah. Okay, let's continue.
Also, there is an activation part and we use to softmax. Softmax function is used to normalize the outputs. And we use the ADEM optimizer because it requires less memory and efficient. Next.
One more question for you.
Okay, teacher.
Thank you, sir. Why did you use dropout?
We use to dropout because helps prevent the overfitting.
Okay, let's continue.
Next slide. Okay, after the training and checking of the model, the results are shown in this slide. The values you see on the slide are the results of our model with 23 epochs. Our final accuracy is approximately 0.89. Because of this, we decide to use the model for our project. Next. In the left graph, have you seen we pilot the accuracy of the training and validation data? The horizontal axis is the number of pairs and the vertical axis is the error rate. We have a high accuracy value. It's approximately 0.6.
What is the x-axis? Explain it. What is the x-axis?
Error rate.
X, not y. X.
Number of periods.
Periods?
Yes.
Göksu?
Number of epochs.
It is number of epochs, not periods, right?
Okay. And same, I think same, so sorry.
It's not same, it's the terminology.
Sorry, my mistake, sorry.
Continue.
In the loss graph on the right, training loss shows how well the model fits the training data. While the validation loss shows how well the model fits new data, at this point we see that not have a problem with the losses and the model is applied to the data. Next.
I have a question in that slide. In the previous slide, you see that there are lots of fluctuations for the accuracy. And is it the training accuracy? Lots of fluctuations, but in validation accuracy we don't have such. What's the problem here?
Because can I answer?
Who is talking?
Mert Ihsan.
Yes, Mert.
because our validation data is low.
But in the validation data, there is no fluctuation. The fluctuation in the training data, am I right? Am I right? Yes, no question.
Yes, hocam.
Why? Meta?
I don't know.
Okay. Anybody? Nobody? I will explain right now. Because you selected the batch size 8. Okay? 8. 8 is very low number. So for each 8 epoch, each 8 batch size, the data is changing a lot. Remember?
Yes.
You just selected the batch size 8. Sometimes it's lucky, sometimes it's not. So it's fluctuating like if you make it, for example, the batch size 64, then you wouldn't see these fluctuations. Do you understand?
Yes.
Yes, we will try.
You try and then you improve your report saying that when the batch size is 8, the output accuracy is like that. When it's 64, it's like that. When it's 128, like that. So on the right side, you also witness the same thing for the loss. You see that it's fluctuating a lot.
Yes.
Yes, hocam.
Continue.
And next slide, Mart. In this slide, in confusion matrix and classification report, our model's quality can be seen on this slide. I will explain these parameters. A confusion matrix is a summary of the prediction results on the classification problem. For example, you can see in the first row there is a Affion bias, and while our model found 7 correct here, and it found 2 of them as other types. Also, precision is the ratio of correctly predicted positive observation to total predicted positive observation. Examine under 4 different titles. These are the true positive, true negative, false positive, and false negative. It is calculated within the scope of a certain formula and interpreted according to the results. Also, F1 scores is calculated taking into account both false positive and false negatives. Then when interpreting at this point, we can say that our accuracy works best if false positive and false negative have similar costs. At this point, we have interpreted our model according to this. It can be seen that our test data is balanced, and we can say that is a model is a good. Next.
May I ask a question, Mengsu?
Yes, teacher.
Why did you have 63 samples in your test data? Because you said that you apply the data augmentation, am I right? In the test data. Why it is only 63?
Data augmentation to the test data.
Are you sure? So with only 63 test data, do you think that, do you have a good understanding of your model success? Anyone?
No, hocam. We should increase our data set.
So 63 is nothing. And are you sure that you are using the data augmentation in training data? Are you sure that?
Yes, but in the test part, that's unseen photos.
Of course, not unseen, but do you apply the... Okay, let's continue.
Also, here is a rock curve is a very important performance measure for classification problems. It is a probability curve, and there the area under it and out represent the degree or measure of the separably. In this slide, there is a several slope that exist. The Afyonguri, which is color is orange, type has lowest accuracy of rather than others, but we can easily see that the rest of the dam has close accuracy values between them.
Okay, how can you increase these rates? I mean the area under curve values, how can you increase? Or how can you increase the F1 or precision and recall in your project? Have you tried anything? Thank you so much.
No, no, we tried.
In the different epoch numbers, it's change actually.
First, you need to increase the number of data samples first.
Right.
Then you need to go over your network, and instead of updating the last 15 layers, maybe you don't do this, right? In your model, you might change the dropout layer percentages, right? Or you can just add new dense layers between the last layer and the ImageNet, ResNet model, right? Or you can increase the number of the neurons in the deep dense layers. Am I right? You need to think of that kind of things. You should apply. Okay?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we will apply.
Let's move on.
Hi, everyone. I am Mert İhsan. We will deploy our model in Android Studio. That's why we use TensorFlow Lite. The model we trained here is converted to TensorFlow Lite model. We are optimizing in here our model because Android Studio accepts TensorFlow model Lite under 200 megabyte. In here, we are checking our TensorFlow Lite model details. As you can see in here, input shape and the output shape in here, which is plot 32. Because there are seven classes, the model's output is one-dimensional tensor with seven outcomes in here. In this part, we test our TensorFlow Lite model. We use Afyon Beyaz Merlin photo. We create an NumPy array with float 32 type, which is the shape and date of our model by passing the given photo through preprocess. We are taking photos and we use preprocess steps in here, as you can see. After importing our model, we give the preprocess photo to model. The index with the highest number in the tensor returned from the model becomes our class value. As you can see in here, the highest value, zero index. Afyon Beyaz is in the zero index. It's predicted Afyon Beyaz true.
But you give the output details zero index, so you would get the text output, or you just get the index of the output here.
We are looking the.
So you need to use a dictionary, I believe, right?
Yes.
You need to use a dictionary to convert the index from, for example, zero to Afyon Beyazı. Am I right?
Yes, hocam. In the Java part, we are using an array, which is classes array. We are looking at the height
index. Dictionary. Okay.
Okay, hocam.
Lookup table, right?
Yes, hocam. In here, I will show you how we implemented our TensorFlow Lite model into our Android Studio project. First of all, we come to app section and right click on it. Then we choose the new, and we choose the other, and then we choose the TensorFlow Lite model. And after that, we will come by a window like this. From here, we find the location of our model and edit the Android Studio project. Press the finish button. As you can see in the machine learning section, we implemented our model, .tflite. Now on, Metehan will continue.
Hello, I am Metehan Uzun. In this part of presentation, I will introduce our Android application. In this part, I will explain the general design, functions, and background of the application. Next. We use three buttons on the interface. The first of these is the camera button, which allows us to take pictures using the camera. The second is the gallery button that we use to classify the currently existing image. The last one is the exit button, where we exit the application. We used one image view and four text view elements. Image view is used to display the image we have taken or selected from the gallery. Text views are used to display what our result is and show the prediction. Next. In the first part of the code, there is onCreate function. In this function, we declare that which of the elements we use on application. This function is our start function, that when application started, this function works. Next. In this part of our code, we define the set on click listener functions, which we specify what happens when we click the buttons. We need to define the intent variables, especially for the camera and gallery button. This variable is used to open a separate page within the application. Next. Gallery and camera function gives us a different request code value. According to this value, it is processed on activity result function. In fact, as a result, both are converted to bitmap image format and sent to the classify image function. This function, in this function, all the processing is done. The difference between these two if-else parts is that the image taken from the camera also saves the information. Next. In the classify image function, we process the information of the model we get from the tflite file. This function accepts a bitmap image. We send the image that we have taken from the camera or selected from the gallery to this function. This function firstly converts the image it receives into a matrix with its byte by byte values. It checks and saves the RGB, red, green, blue values of each pixels and goes to the next stage. After obtaining the value of the marble for which we want the information, we compare this value within the classes we have. Next. Finally, we print the closest class to the value we have. In this part, we can see our classes string array. According to our value, its strings indexes increase and stop when it nearly our expected value, the actual data. Next. This is a short GIF or predict. Next. Thanks for listening.
Okay, so I understand that you can apply this onto your smartphone, right? Android phone, I believe.
Hocam.
Android phone or device.
Okay.
But on Android.
On Android, okay, it's okay. But you have some problem with your model and it is success rate, okay, performance. Because mainly due to the low number of samples, please increase these, okay?
Yes, and, according to your helps, we will change this that values.
So please update your report accordingly. So please just try to other models and see that if it is changing the result, okay, the performance.
Okay, okay.
Do you want to tell me anything or report anything? Do you think? Do you have anything to report more?
No, John.
No.
That's all.
Okay, then. Thank you.